We know that Don Jr. interviewed candidates for Secretary of the Interior. We know that Eric Trump sat in on meetings, or at least a meeting, with Mitt Romney. We know that Ivanka Trump sat in on a meeting with the Japanese Prime Minister. And we know that Jared Kushner handled invitations for this tech summit. Is this the level of family involvement that the country should expect going forward?
Well, let's keep going with what else you know, which is every one of those people was listed on the transition team website. They're all have been named a senior part of it. So this is a totally transparent process. The people that he has trusted, he's made it very clear how much he values the input of his family. He put their names on the transition committee.
So it's been very transparent.
There's a big difference. I think that as he continues into government, there'll be some discussions about what roles everyone's going to play, whether it's with the businesses he's talked about with Don and Eric, or with Ivanka and Jared. But the bottom line is that he's been very clear from day one with his family, with the role his family plays and the trust that he has in them in terms of help guide decisions.
If his sons are going to run the company, which he at least has said in a tweet, why are they involved with deciding cabinet positions?
They're not involved in deciding every decision.
Why are they
let me answer the question, though, because I think every decision is ultimately made by Donald Trump. But there are a lot of people. I mean, look at the folks today. There are people, you could argue that these tech titans, they're coming in and giving him advice and opinions. Ultimately, he'll make every decision.
They're not family members of his.
But they have an interest in what happens in the government. The fact of the matter is that, look, Donald Trump...
They're not family members of his.
Sure, but I get who, they're not family members. But he has been unbelievably transparent in the role that his family will play in this. I think from day one, not just recently, since going back to that debate in August of last year, he was very clear of the role that the family was going to play in the campaign and the government and in his business. So I don't
he
think
he did
that
not say that they were going to play in
I get it, but he also he
debate,
wasn't the president
Sean,
elected
in,
that.
He said in the debate, he said, I'm going to run the government. You have fun with it,
right,
and run the business.
And then he put every one of them on the transition team, made it very clear that they were going to be part of this process.
Do you understand how people could see real problems with conflict of interest with his family members?
Well, I think conflicts of interest
between
arise.
Between the ties between a Trump White House and
But conflicts
Trump
of interest arise when you're sneaky about it, when you're shady about it, when you're
no,
not transparent about it. And if you tell everyone, here's what's going on, here's the process, here are the people that are playing a role, that's being transparent. What we've seen in government for so often is that people have been shady about their roles, hidden things, not released things. Every one of these things, we have a camera, for goodness sake. Every single person who enters Trump Tower, you get to see them go up, come down, they talk to the press. I mean, this
a camera
is a very...
in the elevator bank of Trump Tower does
negate
a conflict of interest.
I get it, but when is it enough? At some point, the level of transparency has exceeded probably any modern president in terms of who's involved.
No, then that's not true.
Really? Who else?
There's
have
a
you
level
seen
of
everyone
transparency
else
when it relates to his businesses. No, there's a level of transparency that relates to his businesses. Why
no,
there are
I talked
so many
about
questions
the process,
because we have
Kate.
Not seen his tax returns, and I know we never will. I know we never will, but don't claim that he's the most transparent.
No, I didn't say that. I did not say that. I said this process. Again, you keep trying to deflect. I said the process. Every person, we have a call every morning. We talk about who he's meeting with. They come down. We can see them go in and out. He's talked about everyone that's been involved in the transition process. He listed everyone on his family. He talked about the role that they were going to have.
So this is the level, just to be clear, this is the level of involvement. Two people who are going to run his business are also going to be advising the president.
Well, of course, at this phase right now, his sons and his daughter and his son-in-law have played a very important role. They'll continue to provide counsel to him. Ultimately, he's always the decider. And to the fact, I mean, look at what his approval's done. Since he was elected, his approval rating has risen 20 points. His negative's gone down. The American people. No, because you asked, is this what the American people want? Obviously, they've been clear about the process that he played, and they actually like it. They like the choices that he's making. They like the quality and caliber of the people that he's brought in for his cabinet. I mean, they like the diversity, the thought. So I get that there's this, it'll never be enough with Donald Trump. At what point is it going to be enough?
I think that's taking it a step too far. I think there's a very basic question of the level of involvement that Donald Trump's children are going to have
in his White House. I think for some there is, but for some, yes, because he's
been very... There are laws in the books against this.
And he will follow every one of them.
So Don Jr. and Eric Trump are not going to have...
Mr. Trump has made it very clear that in January he will lay out the process by which he will focus on this country and leave his business to his family and others to run.
And I think you can appreciate this. The reason why there are so many questions is because he has not... He promised to make a big announcement, and that's been pushed back. When is he going to announce how he is going to very clearly split between his business...
In January. before the inauguration. Part of this is, look, no president that we've, I don't think, in history has ever owned so much iconic property.
Hence why there are so many questions and so many potential conflicts of interest.
Exactly. And that's why we're sitting down with lawyers and accountants and making sure that it's crystal clear so that he can focus on this. He doesn't have to do this. The law is clear that he doesn't have a conflict of interest, but he's sitting down.
Donald Trump doesn't have to do some of this. But conflicts of interest that would exist, the involvement of his children, there are laws on the books against
him. He will have all of this laid out before he takes the oath of office. What has happened is that he has chosen to focus on getting a cabinet and personnel up and running so that on day one, real change comes to Washington. That's been his priority, and he's outpacing every president in modern history, not just with the number, but you look at the quality of people that have come through those doors, and he has announced from business, from government, from the military, from academic, top of their class in every single pick. So he is focused on that. What it will have time for is in January, once the lawyers and accountants sit down, they will present a plan to him that he will...
Has it been decided, or is it still being worked out?
Because I think when you have such an extensive business that has been so successful throughout the world with these various properties, it takes time.
Trump's new hotel in Washington. House Democrats say GSA says he's going to be in breach of the lease the moment he takes the oath of office because of the terms of the lease. The terms of the lease say no elected official can be part of this deal. He will clearly be an elected official. What is the president-elect going to do about this?
That fills into what I just said. He's going to go through. He's sitting down with the accountants and the lawyers, making sure that there is a clear split between his business and his ability to focus on this country. But that will be part of the process that is laid out.
Do you have an inkling
of what it's not for me to lay out. I'm not a lawyer and accountant. They have to sit down through these. Because the hotel is just one.
You're going to have to explain it to people who aren't lawyers.
Understood. Right. But right now, the hotel is just the shiny object that the Democrats are going after today. But there are several of these highly iconic properties that are around the world that he has got to sit down and go through the same process, not necessarily the same contract, but in a similar way. Look through them all and figure out what it's going to take. So it's not as easy as just waving a magic wand and saying, let's get rid of this, let's sell it, let's do this. He's got to do it in a way.
Did this catch him off guard?
No, of course not. When you own this much, but I think what caught him, what his focus is making sure that he's got this cabinet ready, not just the people at the top of the level through the departments, but the sub-agencies, the other key players, like at the CIA, DNI, all of those things are going to make sure that he is ready on day one.
You mentioned the CIA. Does he trust the CIA?
Yes.
Then why does he not trust their assessment and say he doesn't believe their...
That's not what he said. What he said was there was a report coming out of two papers that made a conclusion that said the following. It said that in part the conclusion of the intelligence collective agencies was that...
And Kellyanne Conway then followed up and said that there are politics in this assessment.
The conclusion of the intelligence agency was based on the fact that the RNC was hacked. The FBI has backed us up, according to CNN's own reporting, that the RNC wasn't hacked. Therefore, logically, if that was part of what was used as the conclusion must be flawed. That's a simple logic. But it's amazing to me that for all the talk about this, this is people trying to delegitimize an election which he won overwhelmingly. But it's also interesting that the conversation that occurred before November 8th was the government and everyone out there talking about the integrity of the system. There's no way anyone could involve themselves in an election. The second that Donald Trump wins and the coronated person in Hillary Clinton didn't win, suddenly now everything's called into question. Where was the government? Where were all these folks on the left calling into question all of this prior to November 8th?
Is the president going to get more than three daily briefings, presidential daily briefings?
He gets one every day.
But he gets it from Michael Flynn.
Okay, who's his national security advisor.
Why wouldn't he want to get it from the source?
He gets it because he does get it from the source.
From
his national security advisor.
Michael Flynn gets the presidential daily
briefing
from the briefer.
And then Michael Flynn relays it to Donald Trump. Why wouldn't Donald Trump want to get it from the source? Some days he gets two, some days he gets one.
Mm-hmm.
But at minimum, he's getting an intelligence briefing every single day.
Why wouldn't he want to get it from the source?
He is getting it from, the national security advisor is the source.
Relaying the source of the information CIA and the...
3 days a week he gets the PBD. Every day he gets the intel brief from his national security advisor. So I think that this is sort of a semantics thing.
Sure. Great to see you.
Thank you. See you.
Thanks so much. Coming up for us, he was one of America's most...